Hi all. In this video, let's discuss some of the React.js best practices. So let me go one by one. So while you're defining any component and you're passing a properties like this, don't use the DOM component property name. So here style is also the DOM property. We'll be using styles for the DOM as a notation for the DOM. So don't use like style or class name like this. So this may create confusion while you are using these properties in your component. So try to avoid using the DOM component names. So try to use as much as similar words like variant or something else like a color variant like that, which defines your property, exact property name. So the second point is like, we may have confusion like when to use double quotation or when to use a single quotation. Most of the cases, there may be in no error. You can use single quotations, double quotations, anywhere, you will not be getting any errors, but you need to maintain some consistency so that throughout the code application, everyone will be in a sync. So for that, use double quotations for the JSX. So like you're using a JSX like this. So then use a double quotation for the JSX attributes. Double quotations, and throughout the remaining part, you can go with the single quotations like this. In other parts, wherever you are trying to write your JavaScript code, then you can use a single quotes like this. So this is a best notation. So everyone in the team can follow the same things. Okay. So the third point is like, use the component name in the upper capital case. So registration form. So this is a component name. The component names should be like this in the capital case, and the instance names should be in a camel case like this. So you have imported some component, and if you're trying to use that component, it means an instance of that component, then try to use the camel case. That's the one thing. And coming to the another point, if you're trying to use the property names, so this is a component and the property names should be a camel case. So here you have used a capital case. So instead of that, you need to go with the camel case like this. And don't use underscores. And if you're trying to send any of the other component in this component, then you give it in a capital case. You can mention the caps like this. Otherwise, go with the component name with the smaller camel case. Don't use underscores. So coming to the import order. So while you're importing the some things, so try to follow some certain order. That improves the readability a lot. You can go with the alphabetical order or an order like this. Like first thing, you need to import all the built-in imports, whichever you need for your product. So you feel if this is a main core dependency, like React, if you're developing, so React would be your main built-in package or a library. So that should be imported at the first. Later on, given, a new line, space, and thereafter import the third party libraries or external libraries, dependent libraries like Lodash for the utilities and Moment for the time manipulations. So like this date and time manipulations. So like this, the third parties would come the second external dependencies, and thereafter give a separate line, and then after you import internal files, which are like asserts, CSS and your JS files you want to work, you can import those files. So that would be the best approach in importing the things. So coming to the file names and folder structures, right? So first thing, don't use any of the hyphens while you are defining any component. Here, if you define navbar component, so don't give like nav hyphen bar. Don't keep like this. Keep the file name and the component name as the same. So that helps the readability and you can understand better. So also, in a component, define a folder like this. I have defined in a components folder. All the reusable components you can keep. In that folder, I have created separate folder for navbar component. In this navbar, I have given navbar.css, navbar.js, navbar.test.js. The naming convention should be like this. Component.css, component.jsx, component.test.jsx. Like this, you need to define. I will explain about this index.js in a while. So this is how you need to define your files. And coming to the folder structure. So all the assets means like images or CSS files, fonts, those things will go under this assets folder in SRC. And in the components, you need to define your reusable components. And in the pages, you can define each route. So whatever the route you're going, so that would be the containers. All these containers can go into this pages folder. and services, the API calls you can use in this service folder. All the API calls can be in go or keep in this services folder. And coming to the utilities, like if you wrote any of the functions, helper functions, those type of utility functions can go into this utils folder. So this is how your folder structure should be there. So this will help a lot. This organization of the files will help us a lot in saving the time. And readability also increases a lot. And coming to the index.js file, I have said this index.js. The purpose of using this index.js file is, so in any of the component folder, you will be having separate components, folders like this, navbar like this. In that, you should define an index.js file like this and just import the components which you are using in this folder. Just import them like this and export them like this. That's it. So what's the usage of this? So let me explain you the usage, exact usage. If you're not using this index.js, you need to import your component like this. In other components, if you want to use a navbar component, you are going to import them like this, like navbar, import navbar, navbar and navbar. Like this, you are going to import in the other components. As you have used the index.js file, you can import like this, just like this. Instead of writing navbar, navbar, just write the navbar. So what happens behind the screens is, so if you wrote this one, it will access the index.js file first. By default, if you wrote like this anything, it will access the index.js file automatically by default. So that's the reason. Now you are importing this index.js file here, which itself is importing the real component. So in that way, you're going to import the real component. So that is how it works. And that is the reason why we are going to import this, use this index.js. It improves the readability. Instead of writing like this, you can just write like this. The only thing is you need to import the components. What are the components you are using in this folder? And you need to export them so that you can use in the other components like this. Also, the other important points to note, the best practices are like follow some ESLint rules. So if you are created your project with the Create React app, it will provide us the ESLint issues by default. The configuration would be by default. If not, config the ESLint issues so that whenever you write any function, it will generate some ESLint issues if there are any. So as on when you fix them. So don't push them to the end of the release or end of the sprint or end of the day. So as on when you write a function, try to fix the ESLint codes. So then and there itself, if you fix, the issues would be less. And also, if you really follow the ESLint rules, then it means your 50% of the code you're writing would be following the best practices. So it means if you keep on fixing the ESLint issues, 50% of your code would be very much It would follow the all the best practices. So try to fix your ESLint code as soon as possible. And as soon as the function or the feature you're done, try to fix them. So at the end of the day, the count would be less and you can easily fix as on when the issues are raised. So the another point is remove the consoles and debuggers before you're committing your code to the Git. And also remove the commented code. All these things should be removed before you're pushing your code to the Git. This helps us to debug. In the debug mode, they will be help us. But when they are going to the production mode, this would be an overhead. And sometimes if you keep debuggers like that only, if they are in a developer mode, the code stops at that point in the production as well. So try to remove the consoles and debuggers and write the comments, respective comments to the function. Comments should be used to the function level. Okay. And describe why you wrote that function. And don't try to describe how the function you wrote, like don't describe the logic what you have wrote inside the function. It's good to define why the purpose of the function, not how you have implemented it. So that's about this removing the consoles, debuggers, and commented code also should be removed before you are pushing the code to the GitHub. And the final point is like maintain the good README file. So if you maintain a README file, so which includes the installation steps and guide to follow and what all the component structure and how the component is decomposed and what all the components are available in your project. So all those things should be defined in a README file, which helps us a lot. So that's the main, this would be the key role. It helps us a lot and it saves a lot of time. If a new developer comes into the project, if they can read this README file. They can clearly understand point to point. And also it's good to do a documentation while you are working with the component. Try to define those documentation, what are the props that component is expecting, and what are the props, its types, everything you can define in this README file as on when you completed your development of the components. So this helps us a lot. So these are some of the best practices in the React.js. I will come up with the next part as well. So there are a few more points to learn in the best practices. So thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos.